Welcome to St. Paul's.
We are glad you can worship with us today.
It's been a long, dark night. And I've been waiting for the morning. It's been a long, hard fight. But I see a brand new day dawning. I've been looking for the sun.
Welcome to worship at St. Paul's. We're so glad you could join us.
Welcome to worship at St. Paul's.
It's great to have you with us today.
Welcome to worship at St. Paul's. We are celebrating service this Sunday, the 26th of September. You may be watching this from home today or during the week on the YouTube clip or Friday or apparently Wednesday. Sometimes our service gets repeated on a Wednesday too on Channel 31. So greetings to you all. Special greetings to people watching us from Dramana and Orbost. Also Irene from Geelong, who sent us a text greeting, and Graham from Firmtree Gully. We're really happy that Graham's recent operation went well, and we thank you, Graham, for your prayers for us and for many churches in Melbourne at this time. Special celebrations for certain people having birthdays this week. A shout out to Laura and her dad, Luciano, and her mum, Melissa, who helps us choose music for our services. So happy third birthday, Laura. During COVID lockdown, it's becoming more and more difficult. People are anxious, and so it's really important to reach out to one another and check on each other, how we're going. So if you, during the service, take opportunity to send a text greeting to one another, to our dedicated text number that you can see on the screen now. Pass the peace. Send a question if you like, and let us know where you're watching from, and if there's anything that we can do for you. I'm Pastor Phil Haar. I'm co-leading the worship today with Sue Westhorpe, our lay leader at St. Paul's and a student at Australian Lutheran College. If you'd like to join me later in the today, if you'd like to Zoom in today for some dwelling in the Word, you can do so. That's at 4 o'clock this afternoon. That's Sunday, the 26th, and be glad to have you. Our theme is further lessons on the way of the cross. Jesus teaches us about discipleship being the way of the cross, and today we hear further lessons on that journey for us. I'd like to acknowledge that the land on which we meet was first given by our Creator God to the people of the Wurundjeri tribe, the people of the Kulin Nation, and we thank God for the land's traditional custodians, and we pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging, and we commit ourselves to an ongoing journey of reconciliation in this land and between people of all cultures across the world. Let's begin. Come, worship God who fills heaven and earth, whose teaching is perfect, whose directions are sure. Come, let us worship God as he draws near to us, and let our words and worship, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our first hymn, Come Down, O Love Divine.
Thank you. The Apostle James encourages us, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Let us confess our sins to God and receive the healing of his forgiveness through Christ. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you see all that we do. You know all that we fail to do. We question when we suffer and fail to trust in your care for us. We do not always sing your praises when life is good. We do not confess our sin to one another because we fear shame and judgment. Hard is our confession. Forgive us, Lord. Deep are the consequences of our sin. Save us, Lord. Amen.
I now ask each of you in the presence of God who searches the heart, do you confess that you have sinned and do you repent of your sins?
I do.
Do you believe that Jesus Christ has redeemed you from all your sins? And do you desire forgiveness in his name?
I do.
Do you believe that Christ has made you holy? And do you want to be led by the Holy Spirit to live a holy life?
I do.
Well, upon your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. On behalf of my Lord Jesus Christ and by his command, I forgive the sins of all of you who repent and believe in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Amen. Amen.
Let's take opportunity to share the peace with one another, those that are around you, those that you can contact today by phone or messaging. Oh, send out a prayer of peace. Peace the Lord be with you. Well, the peace of the Lord, and we praise his name singing, Blessed be your name. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray for a strong and sincere faith. Holy God, help us to serve you alone. Take away any obstacles that cause us to stumble or fall in our faith,
and keep us from causing others to stumble. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Now, kids, I want you to see if you can notice what's different about Pastor Phil as he brings a message for you.
Would children like to come a bit closer to the television screen so they can hear me better and see what I've got here? I've got another linen basket, but it's not Pastor Neville's dirty linen, dirty washing. No Sydney Swans jumpers. Oh, I want to introduce you to a member of the Bear family. We haven't got Pooh Bear because he also went to Pastor Neville's place. He's helping him work out how to roll socks or to fold socks. I'm not too sure what you do with socks. Anyway, another member of the Bear family. This is Ted Edward Bear. You can call him Teddy if you like. Hi, Teddy. Oh, my goodness me. You look like you've been in the wars, mate. What's been going on? You can take that mask off. It's safe enough now to take your mask off. Oh, dear. What's been going on? Oh, you were playing a game in the bedroom with your brothers, jumping on the bed, singing, I suppose you were singing that song, Monkeys Jumping on the Bed. No more monkeys jumping on the bed. Is that right? Okay, and did someone tell you to stop? Yes, Mum said, cut that out. But you were having too much fun. Is that right? And then she said, be careful or someone's going to get hurt, but you could barely hear her. That's a bit sad. And one of your brothers pushed you and you fell off the bed and hit your head. Well, what did you learn from that? Yeah, the floor is hard, isn't it? The floor is hard. And the nurses at the hospital are very nice. That's quite correct. Is that where you got that bandage for your head? Yes, well, yes, be careful or someone will get hurt. That sounds like what Jesus is saying to us in the gospel today. He says, cut it out in a special way. He says he loves children and people at church so much he doesn't want anyone to get hurt. No one to get led away by false teaching. No one to get hurt physically or have their feelings hurt. Jesus really cares for us. Last week, Pastor Neville shared with us how we welcome children. When people welcome children, they welcome Jesus and God the Father through Jesus. And part of what welcome is helping, but it's also helping to make them safe. That's why I've got my high-vis jacket on today. I'm safety officer at the church today, making sure that Sue doesn't run around too much and there's no wet floors for anyone to slip over. The smoke alarms are working and all the doors in the church open outwards. That helps us to get out if we need to during a fire. All these things help to keep us safe. But the best way to keep people safe, can you guess? Yes, the best way to keep people safe is to treat them well. To treat them well. The way, look after things that we see and hear, look after things that we say with our mouths, things that we do with our hands, and where we go with our feet. That reminds me of a little song that I used to sing in Sunday school. It goes, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. There's a father up above who's looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. And we can do the same. I'll sing it, but we'll do it for mouth, ears, hands, and feet. It goes like this. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. For there's a father up above who's looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. For there's a father up above, and he's looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. There's a father up above who's looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little hands, or paws, what you do. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Boom, boom. There's a Father up above who's looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. God is really concerned about how safe we are and how we treat one another. And to help us on our way, he sent Jesus to teach us how to treat one another with love. And he's also given us parents, people like crossing wardens outside the school and stop-and-go men who sometimes wear vests like this too, to keep us safe. And we need to listen to them, especially when they might shout out, "Cut that out," or "Be careful," before someone gets hurt. Let's pray. You want to fold your hands, Ted? Okay. Dear Jesus, we thank you that you care for us and you love us so much, that you want everybody in the church and in the world to be safe. Not only safe from the way that we might bump our heads, but also the way that we treat each other so feelings don't get hurt and people don't feel that they don't belong. We want everybody to feel safe and that they belong in the family of faith. So we thank you for people who help us. We thank you for Jesus and your teaching. We thank you for our parents and for our teachers and for other people that look after us, like the police and the stop-go man. Help us to listen to them and also to treat each other well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Phil and Ted, for that message. We're going to hear our Bible readings now, and Trina's going to read to us from the Old Testament. Then we're going to sing a psalm together, and then Karen will bring us our reading from James.
The first reading comes from the book of Numbers, chapter 11. The rabble with the people of Israel began to crave other food, and again the Israelites started wailing and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt at no cost, and also the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now we have lost our appetite. We never see anything but this manna." Moses heard the people of every family wailing at the entrance to their tents. The Lord became exceedingly angry, and Moses was troubled. He asked the Lord, "Why have you brought this trouble on your servant? What have I done to displease you, that you put this burden of all the people on me? Did I conceive all these people? Did I give them birth? Why do you tell me to carry them in my arms as a nurse carries an infant to the land you promised on oath to their ancestors? Where can I get meat for all these people? They keep wailing to me, 'Give us meat to eat.' I cannot carry all these people by myself. The burden is too heavy for me. If this is how you are going to treat me, please go ahead and kill me right now if I have found favour in your eyes, and do not let me face my own ruin." The Lord said to Moses, "Bring me 70 of Israel's elders who are known to you as leaders and officials among the people. Make them come to the tent of meeting that they may stand there with you." So Moses went out and told the people what the Lord had said. He brought together 70 of their elders and made them stand around the tent. Then the Lord came down in a cloud and spoke with him, and he took some of the power of the Spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. When the Spirit rested on them, they prophesied, but did not do so again. However, two men, whose names were Eldad and Medad, had remained in the camp. They were listed among the elders, but did not go out to the tent. Yet the Spirit also rested on them, and they prophesied in the camp. A young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." Joshua, son of Nun, who had been Moses' assistant since youth, spoke up and said, "Moses, my lord, stop them." But Moses replied, "Are you jealous for my sake? I wish that all the Lord's people were prophets and that the Lord would put his Spirit on them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The second reading comes from the book of James, chapter 5. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you ill? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their ways will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel for this Sunday, the 26th of September, is written in the Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 9, beginning at the 38th verse. Glory to you, O Lord. Teacher, said John, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he was not one of us. Do not stop him, Jesus said, for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us. And truly I tell you, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to the Messiah will certainly not lose their reward. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them if a large millstone were hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands to go into hell, where the fire never goes out. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than to have two feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worms that eat them do not die and the fire is not quenched. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt among yourselves and be at peace with one another. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us pray. Jesus, teach us by your word and inform us more and teach us more on how we may follow you on the way of the cross. Help us never to cause anyone else to stumble from their faith. Guard, help us to guard our mouths and our attitudes, and especially we pray that you would make our hearts open to you and your word. Amen. As we study further lessons on the way of the cross, Jesus says back in Mark 9, verse 35 and 34, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. And now, as we look at Mark 9, 39 to 50, we find three further lessons in cross-carrying discipleship. That is, self-denying discipleship. And the first lesson is that Jesus cautions us not to judge anyone else as outsiders or to prevent them from doing good. John reported that he and some other disciples had seen someone driving out demons and healing people in Jesus' name. I'm not too sure if this was a little bit of jealousy because they, in fact, had recently not been able to cast out a demon from someone. And one would think that seeing someone do such a thing would be something to celebrate. But these disciples decided a line was being crossed. The person healing in Jesus' name was not one of their circle, and so they told him to stop. Upon hearing this, Jesus replied, "Do not stop them, for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us." Yes, anyone who's not against us is for us. Now, that doesn't mean any and all groups who refrain from negative comment on the church are actually for us. The point Jesus makes here is that someone using the power and authority of his name to heal cannot in the next moment be against him and his church. Sadly, groups within a church are sometimes challenged for not being authorized or for being out of step with the way that God appoints people to serve him. Jesus cautions us here not to stop anyone from ministering in his name. It seems in today's society, fewer groups and organizations are willing to openly show support to the church. But I wonder just how good we as a church are at affirming other groups and other churches. Service in the world by non-Christian groups is worthy of our support and affirmation, surely. They and the people they serve are made in the image of God, and God is surely not far from any of them. Freely given acts of service are pleasing to God, and so we need to avoid trying to find fault in the good that others are doing. In particular, not to oppose those who serve others in Jesus' name. Now, the second lesson for discipleship in the way of the cross is do no harm. I really mean it. Here, Jesus uses a child to teach us another important principle. Not only are we to serve the least among us willingly, we are also commanded to protect the least among us from stumbling. That is, to prevent them from falling, and certainly not to cause them to sin. Like the Hippocratic oath in the medical profession, we are to do no harm. Jesus says, "This is very serious. I want your ears open. You would be better off having a millstone tied around your neck and being cast into the sea. A large stone which was used to grind grain that was so heavy that a donkey needed to be tied to it to turn it could pull a person to the bottom of the sea and they surely would drown." When Jesus used this image, his listeners were very familiar with what he had said. On more than one occasion, the Romans had carried out executions by tying heavy stones around the necks of their victims and throwing them into rivers and lakes. So Jesus is describing here a horrible death which would be preferable for a person to die than for them to cause one of his little ones to stumble or to fall into sin. Can you hear the seriousness of this situation? How do believers cause others to stumble, you might ask? Well, there are many ways. One is by directly tempting them to sin, or by downplaying the seriousness of sin. Perhaps treating others in insensitive and unloving and unkind ways, we can cause them to sin through rebellion, by sparking an angry reaction in them where they don't want anything to do with us or the church. It may even cause them to leave the church. Other people can lead others into sin by bad example, or be led into sin because other believers fail to lead them into righteousness. Through lack of mentoring and teaching, they may remain weak and never grow into the maturity of faith that God desires for them. And perhaps some others can be led away by false doctrines. Teachers of false religion lead people astray, and God says that the person who offends one of his little ones is in big trouble. In extreme seriousness, Jesus says that if our hand, foot, or eye causes us to sin, we are to take drastic action and amputate that body part so that we will not be not given to its desires. And it would be better for us to enter heaven or this life and heaven maimed rather than to enter into hell where the fires never go out. The hand, the foot, and the eye are our three problem areas when it comes to sinning. The hand refers to the things that we do. The foot refers to the places that we go where we should not go. The eye refers to the things that we see or desire to have that can cause us to be tempted and to fall away. Obviously, Jesus is using an exaggeration here to emphasize the horrible nature of sin. He is not commanding us to mutilate our bodies. After all, no amount of surgery on the outside will cure the problem of sin on the inside. No, what we need is a change on the inside, the heart, a change of heart. People need to be born again. For all our sin proceeds from the heart, Jesus says in Mark 7:18. So when temptation to sin comes into our lives, we must deal with it consistently and decisively. If a relationship is leading you into temptation and sin, perhaps you need to sever that relationship. If an activity is leading you into temptation and sin, well, then cut that activity out of your life immediately. Jesus warns his disciples that nothing in this world is so valuable that it is worth going to hell over. Sin is not something to be toyed with. It has eternal consequences. Sin is a destroyer, and it must be excised from Christian living. Serving Jesus requires sacrifice and purification for ourselves and for the people that we deal with. And now we come to the third lesson in this text. Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. I'm not too sure how much peace there is in your household today. Maybe there are people who have different opinions on vaccination, or maybe there was people with different opinions about the result of the footy yesterday, whether you're the Bulldogs or the Barrack for Melbourne. And then there's others who just look and saw, well, the game should have been in Melbourne anyway, so there's all sorts of opinions. And these opinions can cause a household to be divided. Jesus is encouraging us as a community to have salt in ourselves. That is to be real, to be salty, to be genuine people in our faith, and to be at peace with one another. Not only for the sake of our community, but for the witness that we give to the world. God's people are called to the way of salt and peace. Jesus says, for anyone and everyone will be salted with fire. Fire is an image of purification, a cleansing agent. And Jesus is telling that those who would be his servants can be expect to be cleansed as they follow him through persecution, through fire, through trials. God allows us to go through persecution and trials in order to make us more like Jesus. It amazes me that as I observe the church in places and seasons of persecution, that God produces from those places the most amazing witness to the gospel, to the truth of the gospel. Through that extreme love and celebration of people, of knowing God's forgiveness, as they are surrounded by neighbors who oppose them and persecute them, they show a great commitment to keep on following Jesus, to keep on loving him, even unto death. Jesus says that, and every sacrifice will be salted with salt. This is a reference back to the sacrifices of the Old Testament where salt was added when the offering was made. Salt was a purifying agent and it made the sacrifice acceptable to God. So, in part, when we go through persecution, it also makes us more acceptable to God because we endure as we trust in him. In verse 50, Jesus says, salt is good, and so it is. Salt was a valuable commodity in that day. The word salary comes from the Romans, the way that some Romans were paid with salt. The Latin word salarium gives us the word salary. And often Roman soldiers were paid their wages in salt, which could be traded ounce for gold in those days. And in the days before refrigeration, salt was so important because meat could quickly spoil. But if meat was pickled in salt in a brine solution, it could last quite some time. It could keep for long periods of time, and salt was also good because it made the food more tasty. Salt was also often used to help healing. It would place into wounds, which I'm sure would have been quite a shock to the patient, to help to stop the spread of corruption. So salt was a preservative, a flavoring, an antiseptic, and a currency in those days. Salt is good, but if salt loses its saltiness, what good is it? Salt in our day is pure, and it does not lose its flavor if it's kept in tight containers. In Jesus' time, however, it was often contaminated with other minerals, and after a short time, salt could develop a terrible flavor. Salt, then, would only be fit to be thrown away. So when Jesus says, have salt in yourselves, he means for us to be real. We are to be truly the children of God, not just by our words, but by our actions and by our hearts. That we should act and live like children of God. And there's some ways that we do that. As to celebrate as Jesus' name is proclaimed, and we see healing done in his name, even if it's from outside our circle. That was lesson number one. Number two, having saltiness in our lives means that we also are very careful not to cause anyone to stumble and to fall into sin. We watch our words. We watch the way that we treat people. We just don't prevent ourselves from doing the nasty things, but we also find in our hearts, the new hearts that God produces in us, new ways of speaking and encouraging, speaking with the truth and genuine care and love for other people, that they may feel really welcomed and safe in our midst. And thirdly, another way to show that we have salt in our lives is to embrace the salt of a sacrificial life. That's the way of the cross. Things don't always come easy for us. But when things trouble us and there's persecution comes into our lives, we actually shine brighter. Because people ask, why do you continue to believe in God and to follow Jesus? We get an opportunity to bear witness to that. And as he actively brings life to us in our relationship with him and dwelling in his word and led by his spirit, we bring genuine love to the world. And we live at peace with one another. Discord is overcome and peace is restored when we recognize in each other a shared commitment to Jesus and the gospel. Yes, even with people that we don't always agree with, if it comes down to that, a shared commitment and desire to serve the gospel because what Jesus has done for us. I wonder, at this time, are you finding any difficulty in being passionate about your faith? When things are going well, we're encouraged to sing a song of praise and thanks. I pray that you can find joy and saltiness in times of difficulty. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Are you unsure that you will survive any current trial? When will this COVID ever be over? Well, let's take it to the Lord. Let's draw near to him and he will draw near to us. Let's pray in times of trial. And as James says, call the elders to pray over you and to anoint you with oil. Let's support one another in the times of trial. We don't go through these things in isolation. Jesus is with us. The community of God is with us. And so it glorifies God when we respond to his call to live salty lives of committed living, being humble in service and loving one another as Jesus has first loved us. And living at peace with one another, the peace of the Lord that we pass each Sunday, a genuine peace. It's not just something we give lip service to, but a peace that we seek and we pray for. Let's obey his voice when he speaks to our hearts and leads us on the way of the cross. And the peace of God which is working always beyond our human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen. Well, let's now declare our faith, the saltiness of our faith, maybe. Let's declare our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sing our next hymn, which is a song about saltiness, because we bear your name. Because we bear God's name, we also celebrate the life that he's given us, all the many good gifts he's given us, and so we also share those gifts with the world, not only in our prayers, but the work of our hands too. And so we thank you as you continue to support the work of the church in various ways. If you'd like to try the new way of giving through a text message, you can do that by texting GIVE to the number that's now on your screen. But in whatever way you give, may God continue to bless you.
Let's pray together our offering prayer. Thank you, loving God, for uniting us with Christ and with one another. Lead us to help and pray for each other
and to live our lives in praise to you and in service to all in need.
Amen.
The Lord says through James, pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. So let us pray for the church, the world, and those in need, knowing that God will answer our prayers according to his love and his promise in Christ. Heavenly Father, thank you for including us in the body of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Forgive us for causing others to stumble in the faith. Turn us around to pray for one another instead, and to build each other up with songs of praise to you. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Watch over our children, dear Father, and over all who are young in the faith. Protect them from being misled by others, and provide them with parents and mentors to build them up in true faith and godly living. Bless and protect all students during this holiday break. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Bless your church in its mission and ministry as it shares your love with the world. We pray especially for the Lutheran Church in Australia and New Zealand as it prepares for the online first part of General Synod this week. Bless our Synod delegate, Ben, with peace and wisdom as he takes part. We thank you for the many women and men who serve you throughout the LCANZ. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Have mercy on the people of every land, on those with inadequate water and food, clothing and shelter, income and security. Have mercy too on those who are impoverished socially and those who suffer from the sins of others. Supply their needs and give them peace. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Merciful Father, give courage to those who suffer long-term illness or discomfort. Comfort those who are lonely, distressed, or broken-hearted, especially during this extended lockdown. We pray for health workers dealing with increased COVID infections and hospital admissions. Give them strength, rest, and restoration. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Bless each person in this congregation, dear Father, our brothers and sisters here at home. Turn us to each other with warm love and generous support, ready to give the simplicity of a cup of water where it is needed. Help us to be people of salt, living to glorify you through service of others and denial of self on the way of the cross. Supply the needs of all we know personally to be in want and whom we name now silently in our hearts. Loving God, as we pray,
give us your peace.
Merciful God, you are the great healer, and you provide for all in need of healing and restoration, having given us your own Son. Today we pray especially for Genix, Liz, Leona, Lorna, Ian, Ebrahim, Zore, Parnes, Parsa and Parsam, Melissa, Christina, Liz, Phil, Alicia, Christine, Eric, Valerie, Louise, Simon, and Jack. Hear our prayer and help all Christians to work together in your name to bring healing to their neighbours. These and other prayers of our hearts we offer to you using the words that Jesus Christ himself has given us and who prays with us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And as you leave this time of worship to live the week ahead with your salty, genuine faith, may God bring peace to you and to those that you extend his peace to. And now receive his blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Go now and celebrate when people honor God's name. When suffering comes, pray in faith. In times of joy, sing songs of praise. Persevere in prayer and action, that all may hear of God's love. In the name of Christ, amen. We join together in singing our closing song, I Believe.